Today I'll be talking about antipsychotic medication, and I'm going to divide the medication up into old and new. First of all, the old antipsychotics. These are known as first generation or typical antipsychotics. These were discovered in the 1950s, and the first one in use was in 1952, and this was chlorpromazine. It is still being used today. There were different classes of typical antipsychotics depending on their chemical structure. Chlorpromazine is a phenothiazine, and others in this category include thioridazine, or Melaril as it was known, trifluoperazine or stelazine, and flufenazine, known as Modicate. Now, thioridazine or Melaril was withdrawn in 2005 due to cardiac arrhythmias, which were often fatal. Trifluoperazine can still be used, but the drug company that produced stelazine stopped manufacturing it in the USA in 2004. And flufenazine or Modicate was discontinued in 2018 due to shortage of ingredients, but it is still licensed for use. The butyrophenones include droperidol and haloperidol. Now, droperidol was discontinued as an antipsychotic medication in 2001. This was due to prolongation of the QT interval, which is part of the electrical activity of the heart, and also shortage of ingredients. However, it is still being used postoperatively to control nausea and vomiting. The thiazanthines are still in use, and these include flupentixol, which is Dupixol, and zuclopentixol, which is Clopixol. The substituted benzamide, sulpiride, is still being used. There are some other classes of typical antipsychotics. Now, the exact mechanism of the typical neuroleptics is not entirely clear. However, it does block the action of the neurotransmitter dopamine in the brain. They affect mainly the positive symptoms of schizophrenia, which are the delusions, hallucinations, and thought disorder, and have less effect on negative symptoms, although some of them, such as sulpiride, may have an alerting effect. One reason why they are not used as much as the atypical antipsychotics is because of their side effect profile, not because of their efficacy. They cause what are known as extrapyramidal side effects, and these include Parkinsonian symptoms, which are tremor, rigidity, and poverty of movement. They also include akathisia, which is restlessness, and tardive dyskinesia in longer term use, which is abnormal repetitive facial movements such as lip smacking or poking one's tongue out. These are irreversible and are not amenable to treatment or discontinuation of the antipsychotic medication. The extrapyramidal side effects can be treated with antimuscarinic medications such as procyclidine. However, this should not be used routinely. Going on to the atypical antipsychotics now. These are also known as second generation antipsychotics, although the medication clozapine was discovered over 50 years ago, but is known as a second generation antipsychotic. These drugs are used because they have a better side effect profile and are less likely to cause the extrapyramidal side effects. They have a lower affinity to the dopamine receptors than the typical antipsychotics, and have a higher affinity to serotonin, and also have an effect on the noradrenaline and acetylcholine receptors. Some of the atypical antipsychotics include olanzapine, risperidone, quetiapine, amisulpride, aripiprazole, and clozapine. I will talk about clozapine separately, but the other medication mainly affects positive symptoms, like the typical medication. They do have their own side effect profile, though, and especially olanzapine and risperidone can cause weight gain, so weight needs to be monitored regularly in patients receiving these medications. Some of the medications, such as risperidone, can cause hyperprolactinemia, which is high prolactin in the blood. This can cause galactorrhea, that's milk coming from the breasts, both in men and women, menstrual disturbances in women, gynecomastia, that's breasts in men and sexual dysfunction. Therefore, prolactin levels need to be monitored in patients on atypical antipsychotics. Now, clozapine is a special drug and should only be used in patients who have not had a response to two different antipsychotic medication. It is used for so-called treatment-resistant schizophrenia. It also treats negative symptoms as well as positive symptoms. One of the problems in using this medication is that patients have to have blood tests. This is because it can cause neutropenia, which is lowering of neutrophils in the blood. And these are a type of white blood cell. So patients can be liable to infections and this could be life-threatening. Therefore, for the first 18 weeks, a full blood count is taken weekly, then every 2 weeks up to a year, and then every 4 weeks after that. So for patients who are phobic or refuse blood tests, this clozapine is not an option. Patients who are on it have to be registered with a monitoring service who will give a green light if the neutrophil count is within normal limits and may give amber or red. And if a red result is given, then the medication must be stopped immediately. Another problem with clozapine is that it can only be used in patients who are going to be concordant with the medication, i.e. they agree to take it and take it regularly. Because if it is stopped, because it's short-acting, a patient will deteriorate very quickly. And also if a patient stops the medication, when they restart it, they have to start right from the beginning again with a low dose and then increasing it over days. Clozapine also makes people feel hungry and they can put on huge amounts of weight whilst on it. People can also hypersalivate, so there is medication that can be prescribed to stop this happening. Often patients will say that their pillow is drenched with saliva in the morning, so we suggest that they put a towel over their pillow to absorb this